Somebody praise the Lord Jesus in this place. Hallelujah. We lift up holy hands without wrath and doubting. We worship you, Almighty God, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, the name above every name, the true creator of heaven and earth, of mankind. We worship you, Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who died on that cross and rose from the dead. Oh, Lord, you are God in the flesh fully. The fullness of the Godhead bodily, as Paul wrote in Colossians. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We praise you today. Oh, we thank you, Lord, that we have your word and we have your Holy Spirit of truth to dwell in us and to lead us and guide us into all truth. And God, your people will listen to you. They will hear your voice and they will follow you. That's what you said. Lord, we pray that happens today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated this morning. Already getting tongue-tied. I made up a new book. Galatians. Oh, Lord, you can tell I've been staying up too late. Oh, have I ever been studying, yo. I've been digging in. In fact, today's going to be a little bit of a introduction to what we're going to be getting into at Skyfall. Really, to tell you the truth, what I've been studying could be a series that I may have to just do because there's no way to cover everything. But and a lot of it is stuff that I have known for many, many years. But just, I don't know, refining it and taking it deeper. And especially I am learning more about our early church fathers. You know what I'm talking about? Not the Roman Catholic ones. I'm talking about the guys that were discipled by John, like Polycarp, and then his disciple Irenaeus, and people like Ignatius of Antioch and Clement of Rome before the church at Rome became the Roman Catholic Church. These guys that were taught and trained and discipled by Paul and by Peter and by John, it's amazing when you start reading their writings and how God preserved his word over the centuries, the New Testament, as it was given to the apostles. And that's what we're going to be covering that in great detail at Skyfall. But I want you to turn with me. We're going to take a little journey through the word today. I've entitled this one, Death in the Pot. Death in the Pot. All right? There's death in the pot, all right. We're going to find out primarily who it's from. Did you get the picture I sent you? Okay. But let's go to the book of 2 John. Did I say 2 John? I hope I did. Now, you know, you guys know, our church knows, anybody who's been listening for any amount of time knows that I cover this passage quite a bit. And I may repeat it at Skyfall, but this is vitally important. And we know the Apostle John lived longer than all the other apostles. He lived well into the second century AD and discipled a lot of people. After he was released from his exile on the Isle of Patmos, he went back to the church in Ephesus, and there he pastored, and as the apostle, he trained many others, and they sent missionaries throughout the world, and that's where he wrote. It is believed that's where he wrote 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John there during that time period. In fact, we are not sure how long he lived. The Lord may have let him live all the way to 120, but he was the only one that did not die a martyr's death. He died of old age, and that was because God wanted everything from him to be passed on to the next generation. And it's just a beautiful thing when you see how it was passed on and how we have just devils in the church world today, in seminaries and Bible colleges, that will say stuff like the book of Revelation was not in some of the manuscripts and all this nonsense that they say, or 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, or 1st and 2nd Peter were not, or books in question. Let me just tell you, you have been fed so many lies. And let me just go in and tell you right now, as for the English-speaking people, if you don't have a King James Bible, you don't have the Bible. You don't have the original words of the New Testament translated and given to you perfectly. You have a corrupted Bible version. And I don't care what scholar or Bible college professor or seminary graduate tells you differently. I'm going to prove this to you, not today really, but we're going to get into that in Skyfall and beyond. But we have the Word of God here. We have the inspired. God promised, and in Psalm 12, he said that he would preserve his word for all generations, right? I mean, you got people in Bible colleges teaching that Moses probably didn't write the first five books. Let me tell you. You want me to tell you who that is right there? That's the Jesuits. You want to hear the Jesuits' voice? The Jesuits' voice are coming out of these Bible colleges and seminaries. Their voices are coming out of these translations of the Bible that have been corrupted by them. I'm going to tell you right now. I'm going to prove it to you by them. The Roman Catholic whore of Babylon has been at work for centuries trying to corrupt the Word of God and get people to follow them instead of following the Word. That's what the battle has been, y'all. And it's been a bloody battle. You go back and you look up people like the Albigenses, the Waldenses, the Lollards, these people that the Roman Catholic Church brutally tortured and massacred simply for preaching what we preach today, what I preach, I should say, not with all of what we preach. But this right here is vitally important. Let's look at 2 John. Let's go down to verse 9. He says here, "Whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ hath both the Father and the Son. If there come any unto you," did it say anybody? I don't care what the degrees beside their name or what seminary they went to. It doesn't matter. "If any come to you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. For he that biddeth him Godspeed is partaker of his evil deeds." So not only are you to abide and remain in the pure, sound doctrine of Jesus Christ as he gave it to his apostles and prophets, but you are to not even be a partaker, not even to say, "God bless you," if someone comes teaching something contrary to this book. Now, let me give you an example here. You know, Jesus said, if anyone say, "Lo, here is Christ," or "there," believe it not, right? Yet a Catholic priest will get up and do his Latin hocus pocus over a wafer and say that this wafer becomes the actual blood and body of Jesus Christ and put it in a little tabernacle and people will bow down and worship it. He's literally saying, "Here is Christ in my little cookie." That's called transubstantiation. Over that false doctrine right there, that false doctrine, and because there were Christians like the Albigenses and the Waldenses and the Lollards and the Puritans and the Reformers stood against that and said, "That's not what the Bible teaches. What you're teaching is false. It's not what Jesus taught." Many of them were tortured, buried alive, burned at the stake, cut to pieces, simply for saying to the Roman Catholic Church, that is a false doctrine. Not to mention every other thing like purgatory. There's no such thing as purgatory. Infant baptism. You don't get baptized until you're born again. Anabaptists, they died under the wicked evil hand of the Roman Catholic whore of Babylon for simply saying baptism is only for those who understand salvation, who have been saved, born again through faith in the blood of Jesus. You don't get baptized as an infant and automatically be made a Christian because you're a Roman Catholic. And then don't even get me started on the worship of Mary and praying to dead saints. Now, don't get me wrong. I know there's some very sweet and sincere and godly Catholic people that have been just brought up in that tradition, and they don't know any better. That's all they know. Now, if they would ever read the Word of God for themselves, then guess what would happen? They would see it. That's what happened. You know, we forget that the reformers like Martin Luther and Erasmus and all these other guys started out as Catholic priests until they actually read the Bible. And I'm not talking about the Roman Catholic Latin Vulgate Bible, when they actually started reading the original Bible as it was given to the Greeks, and then the Greeks preserved it and then brought it into Europe after the fall of Constantinople. Folks, the war, we're still in this war. Let me just tell you right now, we're still in this war against Rome every day. The hierarchy of the Catholic Church, even many Catholics are beginning to realize, like Pope Francis, how far off he is from the Bible. And they don't even have a correct translation of the Bible. And they've been behind every scheme to undermine the scriptures and the truth for centuries. And that is why I know that the Roman Catholic Church is Mystery Babylon, the great harlot, the mother of all abominations. The reason I know that she, it says she is drunk with the blood of the saints and the martyrs of Jesus. The Roman Catholic Church has been killing Christians for centuries. Now they do it secretly. Now they do it by, well, they did it back then too, by proxy armies as well. Oh, don't even get me started on how they took over our intelligence agencies and used the United States military to do their dirty work. Don't even get me started on that one. Go to Matthew 13. I'm going to show you something. Well, actually, before you go to Matthew 13, I'm sorry. Go to 1 Timothy chapter 5, and then we'll go to Matthew 13. Y'all don't mind if I preach a little bit today. You know, something I've learned as you read these early church fathers like Irenaeus and Polycarp and Papias and, gosh, Ignatius and Tertullian, start reading their writings. You know what they were doing? Most of what they were doing was fighting false teaching of the Gnostics and other false teachers, false prophets. Sad thing is, Tertullian was one of Christianity's brightest, most prolific defenders of the faith. And then he even got led astray by a false prophet at the end of his life, because he didn't stick to the Word of God. This is why I want to tell you how important it is that you read the Word, study the Word, know the Word of God for yourself, and have the correct translation of the Bible in your hand so you can know what it says word for word and not somebody's paraphrase. I'm going to tell you, even the NIV paraphrases. I want word for word. I want what God said. And boy, let me tell you something. We are going to destroy, in Skyfall, these attacks on the King James Bible. It's all a bunch of propaganda to keep you from the Word of God that has not been corrupted. And this is not something that I've been preaching this for 37 years. This is not something new. I just keep learning more and how deep this corruption goes. But 1 Timothy 5, I want to read something here. Somebody say pure doctrine. It's what the fight's always been about, pure teaching. Because pure teaching of the Word of God leads to life. It leads to salvation. It leads to repentance. It leads to the fear of the Lord. It leads to holiness. False doctrines always lead you away from those things. Here's what he wrote here. Paul wrote to Timothy, and he said this. And Timothy was a young man, but he was, I believe, being trained to be not just a pastor, but I believe he was an apostle, an overseer. He said, let the elders that rule well, verse 17, I'm sorry. Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and doctrine. Somebody say labor in the word and doctrine. What did I told my family the other day, I was like, I'm getting worn out sometimes. I'm studying so much And I said, it's just laborious. And they were like, oh, that's a, they were just freaking out that I said that word, laborious. Because I don't ever say, but it, I mean, really, sometimes you just are like, even Solomon said that it's, the much study is weariness. I mean, I keep going, and it just keeps, the onion keeps getting unpeeled, and it's just layer after layer. And I'm just like, I'm sitting there most of the time these past few weeks studying all this going, how am I going to condense this down that it's not three-hour sermons or teachings? But there's so much I want to share with you. But he says here, verse 18, he says, for the scripture saith, thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out the corn or the grain, the kernel, and the laborer is worthy of his reward. Now, let me stop right there. And the reason I'm bringing this up, because the Bible, you let the Bible interpret the Bible, okay? So what picture he's giving here is faithful elders who are laboring in the word and doctrine to break it down and give you the truth is the picture of the ox treading out, breaking down the kernels of whatever kind of grain or corn, breaking it down into meal so that it can be made into food, right? So that's the picture he's giving you, all right? Now I want you to go with me to Matthew 13, to Jesus' shortest parable. It's the shortest parable, yet it really has, I think, has the most depth and warning to it. And it's just one verse, verse 33. Imagine that. And it ain't good. He was giving us a little hidden warning here. Not that he hadn't told them plainly, but remember, he said, I'm going to speak to them in parables. And he says here, he says, another parable spake he unto them. The kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven. Somebody say leaven. Which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal till the whole was leavened. Oh. Now, let me just go ahead and tell you right now that in the Bible, leaven is not a good thing, right? In fact, Paul uses it at the terminology, purge out the old leaven that you may be a new lump, right? Talking about false doctrine, talking about sin. Jesus used the terminology talking about the doctrines of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, which were false doctrines. And he said, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. Beware of the leaven of the Sadducees. So somebody say with me, leaven is a bad thing. So he's saying here that that this happens in the kingdom of heaven. So he's talking about the church world. He said, this is going to happen to you. He said, a woman, and I'm going to tell you who she is, the harlot, the whore of Babylon, the Roman Catholic Church. She's going to take leaven, false doctrine. And she's going to put this leaven in the meal, in the preaching and teaching of God's word. And even into translations of the Bible. She's going to sow this leaven. And eventually, what happens? As time passes, it infects the entire thing. I look at how many, everybody tells me this, they say, Pastor Dean, they'll say, there's just no churches that are just preaching and teaching so the stuff you're preaching and teaching, that they're not warning us about false teaching, they're not warning us about what's coming upon the earth. And I'm sitting here go, well, do you know of a church in my area? I get to ask that more than anything else. And I say, I wish I could tell you one. And I'm not saying there's not any, but I can tell you this much, churches that fight this evil world system, the Roman Catholic Church, all the false doctrines that have permeated the kingdom of God, the church world, they are few and far between. Most of them are just riding the wave of this lukewarm, watered down, leaven-filled kingdom they're in. Oh, the mega church, come, let's do life together. They want to be like little surfer dudes. They'll just surf this wave of false doctrine until we end up in hell. Oh, it's just everything's so nice and sweet. Why did all these Christians for centuries tortured, beaten, brutally murdered for just standing up for the truth? And we got a bunch of little pamby, mamby, wimpy Christians now that are afraid to say anything to anybody. I didn't want to offend anybody. I didn't want anybody mad at me. If they don't want to kill you, you're not doing much. Jesus said they will hate you. If they hated me, they'll hate you. Does anybody hate you because of your bold stand for Jesus Christ and his truth, his word, sound doctrine? Does anybody hate you? Has anybody separated their company from? Has anybody maligned you and reproached you and lied about you and spread rumors about you? Man, when I moved here and started preaching, I was called the spawn of Satan. I was called pure evil when I came here to start this church. I've been called everything. And over the years, I've had attempts made on my life. When I confronted a Jesuit-trained false prophet in a church, confronted him and exposed him and pointed at him in front of his church people and said, "You are a prophet of Baal," I was shot at the next day. Bullets were hitting all around me and whizzing by my ears. Stand up for Jesus and preach the truth and be living it, and you will be hated. And the Roman Catholic whore of Babylon and her agents that are everywhere will try to kill you. And if they can't do it quietly, secretly, through poison or this or that, they'll try to destroy your reputation, get you canceled, censor you, throw you in jail. And this is just going to increase. Do you know, I think that, what, 8 of the 9 Supreme Court justices are Roman Catholic? Yeah. Joe Biden claims to be Roman Catholic. Nancy Pelosi, any devil can be Roman Catholic. It's easy, right? Because it's not about repenting and living for Jesus. It's about, just go to confession to a priest and he'll absolve your sins. The priest will forgive you. Not Jesus, but the priest will forgive you. And then you'll be forgiven. The Roman Catholic system is a Babylonian system of idolatry and paganism mixed with Christianity. And she is responsible. She is responsible. Matter of fact, it says she's the mother of harlots. A lot of people don't know. Don't know that the Roman Catholic Church spawned communism. She spawned the Nazis and supported Hitler. And Hitler said he was only carrying out what the Catholic Church was doing to kill the Christians and the Jews. He was an agent of Rome. They picked out Muhammad and trained him. And Muhammad turned on them, though. But they trained him. They were going to use him. Why do you think there's a book in the Quran about Mary? They have no respect for women in Islam, but yet they hold up Mary up here. Why do you think that is? Because, see, Muhammad's first wife was a Roman Catholic. And her brother or uncle or somewhere, I can't remember now, was a Catholic priest. They were recruiting him and training Muhammad to bring the Arab people under the Roman Catholic Church. When he figured out he could just create his own religion and go with it, is what he did. But when you know the truth, you can literally see that why the Roman Catholic Church, the Vatican, is the mother, the producer, the birther of all these abominations that are throughout the earth, and why the kings of the earth run to commit fornication with her and kiss the ring of the Pope. There was a Roman Catholic who decided, who realized what was really going on and refused to kiss the ring of the Pope. His name was John F. Kennedy. When he went to the Pope, he refused to bow, he refused to kiss the ring, and they blew his head off. A lot of you don't know this, but Keith Green, the great singer and prophet of the 70s and early 80s, had just started a series in his Last Days magazine exposing the false teachings of the Roman Catholic Church called the Catholic Chronicles. And he was having, 40, 50,000 young people come to his concerts. He was leading people to Jesus. He was preaching repentance. He was on fire. He was leading young people to commit their lives to being missionaries. I mean, this guy was having an impact. And actually, Last Days magazine that he produced himself, and I had friends that I know back in that day that worked for Keith Green, that later on I got to be friends with, and they helped produce Last Days magazine and get it out. It was had the widest circulation of any Christian magazine in the world at that time. And he had a private plane, and he gets in it, and the plane goes down. Let me tell you something. That's a specialty of the Jesuit-infiltrated CIA. If the CIA doesn't like you, you probably shouldn't get on a small aircraft. And it killed a lot of his people, him and two of his children. And I believe to this day that Keith Green is another martyr of the Roman Catholic Church. It's interesting that his wife, after his death, removed the Catholic Chronicles from everything. You can still find it. As people still have it. I have it. But the Jesuits are always trying to get rid of anybody. Oh, and they'll come after me again. Because you can't do this without them trying to silence you. Because they are the Jesuits. Let me just go on and tell you right now. The Jesuits, the so-called Society of Jesus, right? This arm of the Roman Catholic Church that was started in 1540. This society, this group of individuals, and it's massive now, it's into the thousands. They make the CIA, MI6, the Mossad look like they're playing tiddlywinks and jacks. You know why? You know why you don't mess with the Roman Catholic Church and the Jesuits? Because they've been around longer than all of those intelligence agencies, and they got their people into every country, every college, every seminary, every agency of government. There are Jesuit agents working against you and me. They hate freedom. They hate America. They're part of this bringing down of the United States of America. This is why Abraham Lincoln didn't even want a Jesuit in our country. And they shot him in the back of the head. And it was a Jesuit that did that. Fauci was a Jesuit. Yeah, he was just making sure. Look, the Jesuits were founded in 1540 for one purpose: to destroy Protestant Christianity by any means necessary. Infiltration, false teaching, scholarship. Let me put up a quote of Spurgeon. I'm not one normally that will put up quotes from Calvinists because I don't. But now Spurgeon, it was amazing because he was a Calvinist, yet his preaching was very not Calvinist. He was very evangelistic. He led many people to Jesus. So he said this, though, in the 1800s. He said, talking about these preachers who don't preach the gospel anymore, that hold back the word of God, he said, they keep back a portion of the gospel having studied in the devil's new Jesuitical college. Let me read to you something. Think about this. The Jesuits started in 1540. To destroy Protestantism. Now get this. So by 1556, so we're talking about 16 years, three-fourths of the society's membership were dedicated in 46 Jesuit colleges in 16 years. They had taken over those colleges. And it says they were opposed to the learning of Scripture. This network would expand by 1749, so about a little over 100 years, 200 years, by 200 years later, to 669 colleges, 176 seminaries, 61 houses of study, and 24 universities that openly say they are Jesuit. I wonder where we are now. That was in 1769. See, this is what they're up against. They want to exterminate Protestant Christianity that preaches the true, sound doctrine of Jesus Christ, that you are saved by grace through faith, not the Roman Catholic Church, that you don't need a popopotamus. I'm going to read you some quotes at Skyfall where they talk about there were priests in that time, Jesuit priests, saying we ought to obey the Pope over God himself. Over Christ himself. This is what you're dealing with. That's why I tell people, my problem is not with Roman Catholic people, it's with their leadership. That's their whole hierarchy is corrupt. If you move up in it, the higher you go, it's obvious, the more corrupt you are. You reach cardinal and bishop and popopotamus. If you choose to be a Jesuit, you know what you're choosing. It says, let me go back to this parable. The kingdom of heaven is likened to leaven, which a woman took and hid. Somebody say hid.
Hid.
It's by stealth. By stealth. See, anybody in here brave enough to say, yeah, I'm holding an NIV? I'll forgive you. Nobody's volunteering, boy. See, that's what you're supposed to do. In the military, my dad used to say, if you're in the military, you don't volunteer for anything, right?
But
let me tell you something. You can hold up the NIV, the RSV, the ASV. You can hold up, oh, God, the Message. What a horrible, horrible, the Passion Bible. The New King James Version. Their heresy, their false teaching, their false doctrine of Rome is hid in there. And Sal, Jordan, myself, we're all going to be covering this. You're going to see it. And it's ugly. But it's hidden in there. And then you have these preachers get up. If you see a pastor using the Message, run. Because he is either ignorant as the day is long and shouldn't be followed, or part of the corruption, he's doing it on purpose. You see a church or a Christian leader talk about the Pope's a wonderful leader, Christian leader, run. Rick Joyner, run. I've been telling people this for years and years. Run from these people. But they're still, because see this stuff, it's hidden. It's hidden, but it's hidden there until what? Remember, you don't see what the yeast is doing at first, right? It's hidden. But you wait a little while. Like when we're getting toward the end of days. Oh, look at here what we got. The whole thing. I can look at Christianity from one end to the other, especially Europe and America and what Europe and America has spread to the world now. The whole thing is leavened. There's only a few of us left standing outside of it going, mm-mm, no. There's death in that pot. But what are we going to... Let me tell you, I said this years ago, and I'm going to say it again, because I wasn't the first one to say it, I found out. I found out I sound like our early church fathers, who I sound like. It's almost, it's no joke. I started reading their writings, and I'm like, that sounds like what I'd say. Right there. You know why? Because we had the same spirit of truth. But I'll tell you this, you find out where a Christian or where a minister stands on the Roman Catholic Church, and you will know whether they should be listened to or not. You want a litmus test? There's you one right there. Because you can't be ignorant of this. And if you are, you should not be in the pulpit. I mean, the whole reason Protestant Christianity means we are protesting Rome. We are protesting that false church. We are protesting their false doctrines that are not the doctrines of Jesus Christ and his apostles. We are protesting their killing and massacring of Christians for sin. We're talking about millions and millions of Christians' blood on their hands. We are protesting that. And I remember when Paul Crouch of TBN got up and said, oh, I'm done protesting. And they let Catholics come on TBN, and God took it all down, exposed everything. See, let me tell you something. You start saying that you start partaking with them and blessing them and saying, oh, come on in here, Father, Priest, so-and-so, and teach and preach like Rick Warren does. God will take it down. God will back away. Judgment will fall upon you if you get in bed with that whore. I think about, you say it didn't happen to Rick Warren? Oh, yeah. That he had his issues. It got exposed. And then what happened? His son committed suicide. Death is in that pot. Rick Warren had Peter Kreeft, who was a Jesuit apologist for the Catholic Church, teaching stuff like he saw a vision of Muhammad and Mary and Jesus in heaven. Muhammad ain't in heaven, folks. Oh, and Buddha, too. What are they trying to teach there? What trying to false doctrine? They're trying to push that, oh, God is love and it's universalism. Everybody's going to heaven. That's the doctrine of the Freemasons. That's the doctrine of every secret society. It's all universalism. But their God of their light bearer is Lucifer, the devil, Satan. Oh, I love the quotes of the quotes of James Madison and them about the Jesuits, that they were just the devils. Did not want them in our country. Would expel them from our country if they caught them early on. But he says, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a leaven which this woman took and hid in three measures of meal till the whole was leavened. The whole thing. Now look at this. I want you to go to Isaiah chapter 1. Woo, I feel the anointing on this. In fact, I love this. One of our greatest prophets that England and America ever had was a man named Leonard Ravenhill. He wrote a book, 1959, Why Revival Tarries. And do you know what he said in there? One of the reasons that America was not having revival and churches were not having revival, he said because they would not preach against that Roman Catholic whore. They would not expose her and deal her the death blow. He said in that book, I have it on my shelf. I've had it for decades. He said that the Roman Catholic Church is the greatest forgery Lucifer ever made, and if the preachers of today would hit her as hard as they can, there would be revival in every place in the world, because that they are the ones guilty of watering down the preaching and teaching, the meal. They're guilty of leavening it. almost every false doctrine there is, I can trace all the way back to the Catholic Church, even as far back into the 400s and 500s with Augustine, who Augustine embraced all the heresies of the Gnostics and brought them into the Roman Catholic Church. He's known as the father of Roman Catholic doctrine, Augustine. And I see Christians putting up quotes from Augustine. I'm like, what are these doofuses doing? Do a little studying. What's the saying about history? If you don't know history, you are destined or doomed to repeat it, right? I like doomed better. Isaiah chapter 1, he says this, and this is this morning the Lord brought this to my mind, just standing back here during praise and worship. What a word this is to the American church and the English church, the Western church. It's amazing how the Great Reformation, Martin Luther, and all the great reformers, and even on into the time of Wesley, that England and America was just a great light of Christianity to the world, of truth, fighting the Roman Catholic false doctrines and leaven. But now, listen, though this was to Israel back in 750 BC, this is a word to America and to the West. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord hath spoken. He says, I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me. His own. So he's saying my own children. He's not talking about people in general. He's talking about my people. And that means Christian people now. He says, the ox knoweth his owner, and the ass his master's crib, but Israel doth not know, my people doth not consider. Ah, sinful nation, a people laden or loaded down with iniquity, a seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors. They have forsaken the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger, and they are gone away backward. Why should you be stricken anymore? You will revolt more and more. And then he says this, the whole head is sick and the whole heart is faint. From the sole of the foot even unto the head, there is no soundness in it, but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. That means rotting flesh. They have not been closed, neither bound up, neither mollified with ointment. That's the anointing of the Holy Spirit. That's the anointing of truth. He says, your country is desolate. Your cities are burned with fire. Your land, strangers devour it in your presence. What is beginning to happen to America? And this is going to happen even on a greater scale in the days ahead. Your country is desolate. Your cities are burned with fire. Your land, strangers devour it in your presence. And it is desolate as overthrown by strangers. That's foreigners. And the daughter of Zion is left as a cottage in a vineyard, as a lodge in the garden of cucumbers, as a besieged city. And what he's saying is that the true Christians are like just a little cottage surrounded. We are surrounded. Do you know that they're closing in the walls upon us? The Department of Defense just issued a decree that the United States military can now take action against civilians. One of the final death blows to the Roman Empire was when they allowed the foreign legions to cross the Rubicon and to begin to fight their own people. That was the end. And that's why we've had the Posse Comitatus Act to never allow the use of our federal troops against our own people. And they just issued an order to just bypass that whole thing. And I thought about it today. The walls are closing. We're like a little cottage that is besieged now, the true people of God. We are the minority, and we are the minority that they hate with a passion. And he says this, except the Lord of hosts had left unto us a very small remnant, we should have been like as Sodom, and we should have been like unto Gomorrah. Do you hear that? And then he goes on to say, and he was like, this is just so good. I guess I need to read it. He says, to what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me? going to church and singing songs, giving your tithes. I'm full of burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed beasts. I delight not in the blood of bullocks and of lambs or of goats. Remember when Samuel told Saul, I want obedience more than sacrifice. I'd rather you obey the word of God than serve in the coffee shop, in your local megachurch. He says, when you come to appear before me at the judgment, who hath required this at your hand to tread my courts? Bring no more vain oblations. Vain means worthless. It is an abomination to me. The new moons and Sabbaths, the calling of assemblies, I cannot away with it. It is iniquity, even the solemn meeting. Your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hates. They are a trouble unto me. I am weary to bear them. When you spread forth your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Yea, when you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil, learn to do well, seek judgment, relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless, plead for the widow. Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If you be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land, but if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. If America ever wanted a word from God, this is to you. There is a remnant. And I believe as these judgments, and as our enemies begin to close in, and as these judgments begin to fall, and as God takes a step back because of our wickedness, and I'm talking about the people of God, I do believe there's going to be a remnant that finally bow the knee and submit to Jesus and repent of their sins and get right with God before they have to actually stand up and die for their faith. But for the most part, the majority... Remember, narrow is the way that leads to life. Few there be that find it, but wide and broad is the road that leads to destruction. Many are going to follow the Antichrist system. Many are going to take the mark of the beast. Many are going to bow their knee to the whore of Rome. Because what's going to happen is the Antichrist beast, the Antichrist, the man, and the beast system, the UN, and the whore, the woman who rides the beast, are going to work together for a while. That's why you see them all nestled up together. Birds of a feather, what? Yeah. If they're not preaching, listen, if preachers aren't preaching against the Roman Catholic whore of Babylon, the United Nations, this Jesuit infiltration of the church, they are not doing what God wants them to do, period. Now let's go to... What's the answer to this? Go to 2 Kings chapter 4. Oh, yeah. Woo. Y'all as quiet as a bunch of Lutherans in here. Y'all just give me an Episcopalian nod, right? A little nod. Give me a Baptist amen. There you go. They'll say it. Hey, the Baptists will say amen in church. I've heard it. Go down to this 2 Kings 4 to go down to verse 38. The prophet Elisha came again to Gilgal, and there was a dearth in the land. That means a famine. Means a time of lack of food. But let me tell you what the book of Amos says. It says, there's a time of famine of hearing the words of God. I think Sal's going to talk about that too. I'm not trying to steal his thunder. But I want you to understand, why is there a famine of that? Because there's so few that preach out of... See, there's two streams of translation of for the New Testament. Two streams. One, the Alexandrian stream that comes from where you get the Vaticanus and the Sinaiticus or Sinaiticus corrupt forgeries of scriptures that are used to translate all these other Bibles. And then you have the Textus Receptus that comes from the Greek text, the original text passed to the Greeks, preserved by the Greeks, and then translated by some of our great reformers like Erasmus, who they tried to malign and destroy his reputation. I'm gonna talk a lot about Erasmus. He was a great, great man of God. And he gave us the first translation of the Greek New Testament from these Greek scholars who he was trained by, that came from that place where they preserved the New Testament for us for over 1,000 years. You know, there's Bibles. I went online. Do you know I could go online and buy a Bible, a New Testament that's in Greek from the 10th century for quite a few $1,000s, but... And they're beautiful. And those Byzantine Greek scriptoriums where they would copy the scriptures and, beautiful stuff. God has preserved his word for us, amen? But there's been a famine, and there was a famine in the land, and the sons of the prophets were sitting before him. And he said unto his servant, set on the great pot and seethe pottage for the sons of the prophets. And one went out into the field to gather herbs and found a wild vine and gathered thereof wild gourds, his lap full, and came and shed them into the pot of pottage, for they knew them not. So they poured out for the men to eat. And it came to pass as they were eating of the pottage that they cried out and said, O thou man of God, there is death in the pot, and they could not eat thereof. Now, it's interesting, and this is something I want to say. The guy that went out to gather this food, to try to find food in this time of famine, his intentions were good. So I'm going to say this. There are some Christian pastors and people that have good intentions. But let me just go on and tell you, as I wrote in the Polluted Church book, that good intentions aren't necessarily always going to give you the truth, right? You can be sincere, but you can be sincerely wrong. And that's dangerous, because false doctrine, false teaching leads to backsliding. It leads to compromise. It leads to sin. Just for instance, the false teaching of once you're saved, you're always saved no matter how you live. That false teaching that came from Augustine, that went to John Calvin, who admits that he was an Augustine disciple, that came into the church world. When people start believing that, every time people start believing that they're eternally secure, no matter how they live, they start living in sin. They start getting into premarital sex, adultery, drinking, drugs. Oh, God knows. God understands. I'm just a sinner. The fear of God leaves. And you can trace that. Again, you trace that false teaching all the way back to Augustine, the father of the Roman Catholic doctrine. But there's death in the pot. And he says, they cry out. Somebody realizes. And let me just tell you right now. Usually, notice it says that, says as they were eating, that they cried out and said, O thou man of God, there is death in the pot. So a few of them cried out that there was death in the pot. And so what did the true prophet say? The one truly following the Lord, truly hearing the voice of God, trying to train these bunch of sons of the prophets, trying to teach them and prepare them. He said, then bring meal. Somebody say meal. Meal. Oh, remember? What is meal? The preaching and teaching of God's word. The preaching and teaching of sound biblical doctrine, the doctrine of Christ, the doctrine of the apostles. He says, bring meal and cast it in the pot. And when he did, what did it do? It removed the death from the pot. This is why it's so important that you know who you're listening to. I remember old Steve Hill of the Brownsville Revival, white cane religion. The blind leading the blind. If the blind lead the blind, both fall into the ditch. And he said, the ditch is hell. And he said, he would say over and over again during that message, do you know who you're following? And does the one you're following know where he's going? Now, Paul said this. It's not that we shouldn't have leaders in the church. He said, follow me, what? As I follow Christ. He said, let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, those who labor in the word and the doctrine. What are they laboring? To make sure they give you sound biblical teaching, sound biblical instruction. You were told by Jesus, beware of these wolves. They're in sheep's clothing. Paul warned they're going to come. And they're going to pervert you. They're going to teach false things. And I love this about what Jesus says to the church of Ephesus when he speaks to John on the Isle of Patmos. And he says, you have tried those who say they are apostles and they are not and have found them liars. Well, how did they try them and test them? It wasn't just in the spirit, but by what they were teaching. See, it says in Acts 2:42 that they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. The true church of Jesus Christ continues steadfastly in the teaching and preaching of Jesus, apostles and prophets. We do not depart from Scripture on anything. And if we see that we are and it's pointed out to us, we change immediately. We repent. And we line up with the Word of God. We line up with sound doctrine. If not, we are headed to death. And if we are teaching it to others, we have blood on our hands. We will be guilty of leading people into eternal damnation. This is why you cannot preach false. You know what I marvel at? I marvel at the lightness. What the Bible calls it, Jeremiah even calls it. He said he marveled at the prophets who were teaching false doctrine. And he said he just marveled at their lightness and their lack of seriousness. You know, a lot of these guys try to be stand-up comics in the pulpit. And I'm not saying you can't laugh and you can't have some joy, but we're dealing with serious stuff. You see these people joking around about very serious things. Let me tell you something God's serious about. He's serious about sexual sin. If you live in sexual sin, you are going to end up in hell. If you don't repent, if you are a habitual sexual sin committer, present tense Greek verb, if you're doing that, you're not living according to sound doctrine. If you're into premarital sex before you get married, if you're cheating on your spouse, if you are addicted and constantly looking at pornography, you are lusting in your heart. There's a lot of men who aren't free yet. You hear me? How do I know this? Because I hear from them, and I hear from their wives. You know what? Your wife doesn't even have to see your computer. She can feel it. She'll just know it. That's something about women. Ain't nothing hiding nothing from them. Especially if one loves Jesus. But you're not hiding anything anyway because God sees everything you're doing. And if you're not free from that, you better get free. You better start getting on your face and crying out to Jesus, set me free. I want deliverance. I want freedom from this. I know this will drag me into hell. I've got to get this out of my heart, out of my life, away from my eyes. We live in such a perverted world now. And I'm not saying it's not difficult. I know it's difficult. I hear from the people all the time about it. But let me tell you right now, you didn't accidentally slip and fall into bed with the honey. You plan that stuff. And that's why there's a difference. There's a difference between stumbling in something, like say you walked in somebody's house and they got pornography on the TV. Well, you didn't plan that. But you going and typing it in and looking it up, you plan that. Getting a hotel room and flowers for somebody that's not your wife. Yeah, you planning that. That's premeditated. Y'all know the difference between manslaughter and premeditated murder? Yeah. And as the old preacher said, you know, you can't help what flies over your head, but you can sure stop it from building a nest in your hair. But I don't have to worry about that. Right? Neither did Elisha. He was bald just like me. You don't have much to worry about either. There's death in the pot, but there's an answer. If some of these pastors would repent and start preaching the whole counsel of God's word from Genesis to Revelation, they would start preaching about sin, specific sin, and what repentance really means, to turn away from it, to stop doing it, to stop practicing it. If they would expose where these false doctrines come from. See, it's not too hard. Let me tell you something. As I've said this, we've had church infiltrators come into this church. And in ministries that I had before, churches that I pastored, and even when I was in churches doing ministry in bigger churches that I was not the pastor of, but I was still in leadership, we always had infiltrators, Satanists, witches, Roman Catholic Jesuits. They're always a little creeping in. But as I said, they'll hide for a while. They'll talk Christianese for a while. They'll act Christian, and they'll fool you for a little while. But see, a devil eventually has to start doing devil stuff. A false prophet and false teacher will finally have to start doing false prophecies and giving false teachings. Or, especially, most of them have sexual issues, and that'll start coming out of their mouth, because from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So you're in a Christian setting, and all of a sudden somebody starts spewing out some perverted stuff and making like it's a joke. They're sowing a seed in you. They're trying to see your response. Or they just can't help themselves, because that's what their heart's full of, is lust and perversion. See, there's certain things, boy, you shouldn't talk about in mixed company. I know a Christian woman who was a pastor's wife back in the day, that in church, like in church fellowships, like when we go downstairs, she'd be sitting there talking in graphic details about what her and her husband do privately. Yes. I'd be like, I had to tell her, you got to shut up. You can't be doing this. And laugh it off. Ha, 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 ha. It's not funny. These little pot stirrers come around. And again, a lot of times they're just going to see, they're testing you, see if you'll compromise with them. Some of them are even couples trying to see if you'll swing with them. Oh, and they love hunting people in church. There's interesting, you know, Proverbs 6 says the adulteress hunts for the precious life. They don't hunt for the fowl that's like them. They hunt for the pure, the precious. They're hunters. That's why adulterers are hunters. They want, you know, they want to corrupt. See, because that's the spirit behind all that is, I want to corrupt what is pure. That's everything the devil is about. Let me corrupt what is pure. Let me corrupt the church. Let me corrupt this child. Let me corrupt this marriage. It's what the demons are doing, and they do it, and they use people to do it. Let me corrupt the Bible. Let's come up with new translations. Let's come up with so many new translations of the Bible that they won't know which one to pick. And then let's talk bad about the one that's actually correct. Oh, I'm going to get the King James only freak. Yeah, see, let me tell you what that voice is. That's that Roman whore voice coming through. They hate this book right here. And everybody that helped bring it about, they tried to kill. Some of them they succeeded in killing. I was reading again about the men that God used to create this translation. Godly scholars of Greek and Hebrew. One of them knew 15 languages. They were not just respected Hebrew and Greek scholars. They were fired up, devoted Christians. We have their quotes. We have their letters. We have their friends' testimonies. We have all this history. And we don't even know it. We don't even know how much blood was shed to give you this book so you would know the truth. How many people died so you could have this? It's time we learn. Amen? See, it's not just appreciating the elders that are alive, but the ones who gave their lives. Like Wycliffe and Tyndale and Huss, who were burned at the stake. Because they dared to translate this book from the original Greek into English. And that was forbidden by the Pope in the Roman Catholic Church. And you were marked for death if you dared talk about giving the Bible to the people. You were the enemy of the Pope. Because it's interesting that anybody who really learns the Bible goes, the Pope is operating in the spirit of Antichrist, not Christ. That's why all the reformers, Wesley, all of them said the Roman Catholic Church is the whore of Babylon. And the Pope is Antichrist. These were the great preachers and revivalists. Can you imagine? Martin Luther knew that the moment he nailed his 95 theses against the Roman Catholic Church on that door of the church in Wittenberg, October 31st, 1517, he knew the moment he did that, it was a death sentence upon him, yet he did it. Because he had found out the truth. He had become born again. He had found out that he had believed lies all of his life. And that those lies had kept him from knowing the true Jesus Christ of the Bible. And he was not going to sit back and be quiet and just let everything go along. He knew he had to stand up. And there were men and women that knew in that day, if I do this, they may come and kill me, my children. They may burn me at the stake, cut off my head, torture me, simply for saying we should have the Bible in our own language, not just your Latin corrupted version. I thank God. Oh, the blood that has been shed. Martyr after martyr after martyr after martyr after martyr. Simply for standing up for what the Bible says. Trying to read this book and preach this book. the whole Inquisition that started in the 1200s, you know what it came over? The pastor of the Waldenses knew the Bible so well, a Catholic priest by the name of Dominic, the Dominic Order, right? You've heard of that? He tried to debate this man and got embarrassed because, as a Catholic, he didn't know the Bible. And this man destroyed him in a debate and his doctrines. And so that man persuaded the Pope and his friend to form the Inquisition to begin to kill these people. He said, I will have your blood, simply because he lost the theological debate. And if you go look at the Spanish Inquisition and the Dominican Order of the Catholic Church, that's why they call it the Dark Ages, y'all. Because the Bible was forbidden to be given to the people, and if you dared to try to do that or preach it or teach it correctly and expose the Roman Catholic whore, she went after you to kill you. So don't tell me. One of the most idiotic doctrines that are around today is that the United States of America is the whore of Babylon in Revelation 17. It is absolutely idiotic, stupid, and false. Jesus even says very plainly in Revelation that he would avenge the blood of his apostles. Think about that. So who killed Paul? Oh, well, some would say, well, now that was the Roman Empire before the Roman Catholic Church. Let me tell you something. Constantine did not convert to Christianity. He wanted to use Christianity for political purposes. As soon as he, quote, became a Christian and stopped the persecution for a while, basically what happened was he created approved churches. And if you were not part of the approved state churches of Rome, then he began the persecution of you. Almost immediately after he did it. A lot of people don't even know that. So immediately around the time of 313 AD, around this time period, is when the state church of Rome. So when the Roman Empire fell, the state church continued. The title of the Roman Caesar was Pontifex Maximus. Guess what the title of the Pope is? They exchanged their military garments for religious robes and Dagon God fish hats. Now, I got some Catholics, boy, they hate me when I go down this road. But I love you. I love you enough to tell you the truth. Jesus said to the Roman Catholic whore in Revelation 18, go ahead and put this up. Revelation 18, I think it's around verse 4 or 5, he says, come out of her, my people. Oh, God, if you're within that, come out of her. Leave that whore. Leave her false doctrines. Here's what's so bad is you may be in a church that appears like it's not Roman Catholic, but your pastor preaches from a Roman Catholic Bible, and he preaches Roman Catholic doctrines, and he's okay with Roman Catholicism. So what has happened is what? The Roman Catholic whore has been working real hard together, these separated brethren, they call us, back into the fold. Just become pro-Catholic. Just say Godspeed and become partakers of what she is dishing out, this whore of Babylon. I say, no, I will not. I will expose every false teaching and every infiltrator. You know, one of my first, and I'll say this real quick, I know I need to quit here, but one of the first lessons God taught me when I came back to Jesus in 1987 was this issue of the Roman Catholic Church and the Bible. Which Bible? And then the Lord, I had me fast for 21 days. And then opened the door for me to go into a church where the pastor had a picture on his desk of where he used to travel around, because he was a singer and played the guitar, and he used to travel around with a Jesuit priest. And he would brag about this, how they were working to bring the church world together. Unity. Unity, unity, unity. It sounds good, doesn't it? Unity and love. Don't be divisive. Don't resist. Just unify with us. No, 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 no. Hell no. You should say no to hell. Just like, remember, Nancy Reagan, to drug, just say no. I'm not going to hell. I'm not getting in bed with her. I'm not going to have blood on my hands when I stand before Jesus. I'm not going to have all of these people who shed their blood and died at the hands of this false church looking at me going, we were burned at the stake. We were hacked into pieces. And you couldn't even preach against it in America? I'm telling you, at the judgment seat of Christ, there is going to be a multitude of pastors and evangelists and teachers and Christian seminary professors standing before the throne, and their hands are going to be covered in blood, and the Lord's going to say, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire. I remember in the book, The Divine Revelation of Hell by Mary Baxter, she said when the Lord took her there and gave her the tour, that there was a man in one of the pits who was in his place of suffering and torment in hell, and he's walking back and forth acting like he's holding the Bible and mumbling something. And when Jesus is with her and they walk up to this, it's like he snapped out of it for a second and he looked at Jesus and he said, I'll preach your word now. Oh, let me out of here. I'll preach your word now. And the Lord said, the judgment is set. Like you should have done it when you had the opportunity. There's no getting out of that place. See, that's why I take this seriously. I am not going to one of them little pits where your flesh burns off and grows back and burns off again. I'm not going there for you, because I want to coddle you and make you feel good. My job is to push you to Jesus if I have to. Push you to repent of sin and get serious about following Jesus. How many times do I have to tell you before you do it? How many times do I have to warn you that your eternity is at stake? How long will you be lukewarm? How long will you keep committing sin and compromising? How long will you keep believing false doctrines? How long will you keep loving these dead churches? You, anybody that heard this today, you will have no excuse at the judgment seat. When you stand before God, you will have no, if you listen to this message today, you will have no excuse. The Lord will say, my servant told you the truth, and you pushed it aside because you just want to keep your little nice little American lukewarm watered down church life. Wake up, Christians. They are coming for us. You say, oh, it couldn't happen in America. Yeah, they're saying that in Australia now, right? I bet they said that before, right? Where's my... I mean, it's near... I mean, you might as well... Australia's turning into the penal colony again. New Zealand as well. England now, you can get arrested for talking against homosexuality as a preacher. You can get arrested. You can get arrested and go to jail for posting something against the government that you don't agree with. And that's happening in England right now. It's happening in Europe. You think it can't happen here? What do you think these people are trying to do to us? What do you think the censorship is about? It's just the beginning. This book will be illegal in the days ahead. You will, but they will probably allow you to have one of their watered down, changed versions. But not this one, I assure you. This one will get burned. That's why, you know, we lost so many manuscripts in those days. Because the Roman Catholic Church would find people with real Bibles and burn them. Burn them in piles. And back then, it would take a scribe nearly 10, 11 months to copy the whole Bible. And they would take that and burn it. Because they didn't want the people to have the truth. Because, see, let me tell you something. If you know the truth, the whole Catholic nonsense comes down to the ground. I remember showing a Catholic, you know, their version of the Ten Commandments is not even right. In their Latin Vulgate Bible, it's completely wrong. They've manipulated it. And I had a Spanish exchange student come and go to our Bible study in Montgomery when I had a Bible study every Friday night in my house. We had 30, 40 people every Friday night in my pack, sitting on the floors in my living room. And I remember this girl started coming to the Bible study, and she got saved. Now, she'd been Roman Catholic her whole life. Her family's Roman Catholic. Her, you know, I mean, we're talking about generational Roman Catholics in Spain. And she truly got born again because she started going to Pentecostal church with us. They were, we get a little loud sometimes, right? Holy rollers. And she got born again, gave her life to Jesus, was truly saved. And right before she goes back to Spain, I ask her, I said, so what are you going to do when you go back to Spain? Where are you going to go to church? What are you going to do? Because everybody around you is going to be Catholic. And she said, I guess I'm just going to go back to my Catholic church. I said, you cannot. And I showed her, I just handed her Exodus 20, and I said, read this. And when she read the second commandment, not the Latin Vulgate corrupted version that does away with the second commandment, about that you are not to bow down to any statues of anything, any image of anything that's in heaven, in earth, or under the earth. You're not to bow down before it because that's idolatry. And the sin of idolatry will separate you from God forever. And when I told her, I said, just read this. And she read it, and she looked up at me, and she said, well, I can't go back to that church. I said, exactly. You got to live for Jesus, not Rome. We got to live for Jesus, not Rome or any of her sister churches that are hiding in our midst. Amen? The gospel of Jesus Christ is not a Roman Catholic gospel. It's a Greek manuscript, New Testament gospel that God preserved for us, and we have it word for word as Paul wrote it, as John wrote it, as Matthew wrote it, as Luke wrote it. We have it. And you can know the truth. And Jesus said, if my disciples, what? He said, they will, what? Continue in my word, and they will know it, and they will be, what? Set free because of it. If you continue, said, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples. You will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. If you continue in the word of God. Amen. Let's stand. I want to lift up holy hands again. God's a holy God. He gave us the holy scriptures. This is a legal document. He calls this the New Testament in his blood, the new covenant, the new contract. This is a contract that God has made. And you can choose to enter that contract. You can break that contract on your part. He will never break it. But if you enter that contract, you better enter it seriously. Because there's been a lot of bloodshed, and the blood of God Almighty was shed to make that contract possible. I can't imagine. Sometimes I can't fathom that Jesus Christ, God Almighty in the flesh, comes down here, but takes on a human body and allows them to spit on him and beat him and pull out his beard and put a crown of thorns on his head and nail him to a cross after they've whipped the skin off of his back. I can't even fathom. But that's what it cost to give you the opportunity of entering into this contract. You better get serious. If you're not serious, you are in big trouble because you are breaking the contract. You're breaking the covenant. Stop cheating on Jesus. Amen. Father in heaven, we come to you in Jesus' name, and I pray for your Holy Spirit to convict, to draw, to open the eyes, to awaken those still in lukewarmness, those playing in sin, sexual sin, lying, stealing, just living immoral, claiming to be Christian. Lord, I pray there'll be true repentance, that people will have true born-again experiences as they make Jesus Lord of their lives 100%, that they get serious about studying the word that you've given us, that you preserve for us, that many suffered and gave their lives and shed blood to make sure that we got the word, the scriptures to us. I thank you for everything you've done. Help us to rise up and be true to the covenant, to be faithful to you, to love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to hate sin, and to truly help, God, help us depart from it. Understand that we must depart from iniquity. We must repent and leave the habitual sin behind us. And you will forgive us. You will wash us clean if we will repent. I pray that many repent and get serious about making you Lord. I pray this today in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, this song says we lift up holy hands. The only thing that can make you holy, that means spiritually clean before God, is that you come to Jesus and say, Jesus, I believe you died for me and you rose from the dead. Cleanse me and make me clean through your shed blood. And if you'll do that for me, I will give you my whole life. I will follow you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. It's called the Great Exchange. You exchange your wickedness and your own ways for his. Amen? All right.
Praise you, Lord. I'm going to lift up holy hands in the presence of the Lord. Oh, lift up holy hands in the get into your presence, Lord.
In the presence of the Lord.
Oh, yeah.
Lord, lift up.
Gonna lift up.
Holy hands. Oh, yeah. In the presence of the Lord.
In the worship you, Lord.
Holy.
You are holy.
Holy.
He is holy.
Holy.
He is holy.
Holy.
So holy.
Holy. Holy.
Every morning he's
holy.
Day after day he's holy.
Holy.
For all of ages and all of
holy.
Time. Never will change. Cause God is a holy God.
Holy.
He is holy.
Holy.
Oh, yes, he's holy.
Holy. Holy. Holy. Wonderful. Marvelous. Glorious. Omnipotent. Righteous and mighty.
You see, he's holy.
Holy.
Cherubims and seraphims
holy.
Go before his throne. He's holy.
Holy. Holy.
And the 24 elders
holy.
Bow and cast their crowns
holy.
Before the feet of the Lord.
Holy.
Because he's holy.
Sing it out to it. He's holy. Yes, yes, yes. Give him praise. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory to you, Lord. You are the Holy One. The Holy One of Israel. The mighty God. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We serve you, the true Creator. We worship you, Lord. Lord, I thank you for this day. God, I pray there be the fruit of repentance. Come forth. Salvation. That people that have been listening will surrender, repent, be born again, and follow you now. Become a disciple of Jesus. God, we pray this today. We thank you for this time. Lord, I believe your word has been sown. I pray now, Holy Ghost power be upon it. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Somebody go ahead and give the Lord praise. Well, this is Skyfall Week, y'all, but you can still register if you haven't. You can still come if you haven't. So go to skyfallconference.org. We'll be here Wednesday night, this coming Wednesday night, for prayer at 7:30 Central Time, 7:30 p.m. Lunch deadline is Tuesday at midnight. So if you want to order lunch and have it there on Friday and Saturday, you better get that done. And let me just say this. Read and follow the directions about how to do it. All right? Because we've had some not do that. All right? It's going to be good, y'all. It's going to be good. Worship's going to be good. You're going to get the word of God. We're going to pray for folks. I believe people are going to be healed and delivered of things. And I'll tell you, I think, you know, this is a biblical principle that, yes, we gather at church weekly, but we have a lot of church family out there that can't come here every week. And a lot of them are like, I want to be in a live service. And it's just amazing. The Skyfalls have been such a blessing because a lot of our church family that's scattered out there that watches every week, they get to come and we get to fellowship, and it's just and it's something about too making that effort to get on a plane or drive for hours, or and I know it costs money for planes and hotels and gasoline, but let me tell you that making the sacrifice to say I'm going to a special time to be with my brothers and sisters, to hear the word, to worship together. God honors that. It's not because we're somehow just super spiritual. God just honors people when they make the effort and they are hungry for true fellowship and the word of God. God shows up. And we're going to have testimonies, and it's going to be great. So please, if you haven't made your plans, you got a few days. We'd love to see you in LaGrange at the Callaway Conference Center. We'll be there Thursday. What time again? Meet and greet 4 to 6 Eastern time. Snacks and drinks will be provided. Early check-in. Get your T-shirt and badge. And the water baptism Sunday, 7 Eastern time here in Opelika at the church. Let me just say this. We are going to have, just like we had every year, we're going to have a prayer team. They're going to have a certain color badge. I don't think we've determined that yet, have we? Okay. Well, we're not going to say what it is. We'll tell you at the conference, but if you come, and for those of us, you here, don't let anybody pray for you, especially people you don't know. We just make sure we do that to protect everybody, okay? Because we will have some, I'm sure we'll have some people come that aren't in agreement with us. So. Yeah. Yeah, if you're meeting with folks at the hotel, that's your business. At the conference, it's our business. Amen? All right. Everybody here at church, stay for just a second after we close the broadcast. Tell bye, everybody. Hug some necks out there before you go eat lunch. But my wife's got a little announcement to make.